Alright?
Yes. Very sweet, very simple. And just let me get the annotator. हाँ चलो लेट्स स्टार्ट. Let's start. So today we are going to take up history and let's see what are the various aspects in it. The first and foremost topic which comes is ancient history. Ancient. We'll start with ancient. Amanvir. We'll start with ancient and then we'll proceed. The first and foremost is ancient history, and in ancient history today we will take up Paleolithic age in India. We'll take up today Paleolithic age in India. Let's see what is there in it. Paleolithic age. All right, what is the time period of it? From 500,000 BC spanned the Paleolithic age, or this age we also call it as Old Stone Age. It starts from basically 500,000 BC, and this Paleolithic age in India we also call it as Old Stone Age. At that time people were using stones and etc for their survival. When you take up the Paleolithic age, it is divided into 1, 2 and 3 phases. The first phase is Lower Paleolithic, which extends from 500,000 BC to 50,000 BC. Then Middle Paleolithic age, 50,000 BC to 40,000 BC. Then from 40,000 BC to 10,000 BC is our Upper Paleolithic age. Okay, and these three classifications, why these three classifications are done? They are done on the basis of nature of tools and climate change that have occurred during these time periods. Okay, the nature of tools which were used in this period in Lower Paleolithic, Middle Paleolithic and Upper Paleolithic, and the climate change which have occurred, on the basis of which we have divided the Paleolithic age into three phases. Is it clear to everyone? Is it clear to everyone? Tell me quickly in the chat. Is it clear to everyone? Guys, come on. Yes. Okay. You have to respond if I am asking a question. Okay. Yes. Okay. What is the timeline? Let's understand the timeline one by one. Three phases: Lower Paleolithic, Middle and Upper. First is Lower Paleolithic age. In Lower Paleolithic, again we know that it spanned from 50,000 BC to 500,000 BC to 50,000 BC. In India, sites were discovered, and what are the sites which shows that represents Lower Paleolithic age? They were discovered in Punjab, Kashmir, Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan. In these are the states we have found out the sites, okay, in which we have got the evidence of Lower Paleolithic age. Similarly, when we will go for Middle Paleolithic age, Paleolithic is basically Stone Age, we call it as, okay, yes. It spanned from 50,000 BC to 40,000 BC, and the sites are Tungabhadra River. The sites are Tungabhadra River Valley, Narmada River Valley. Okay, these are the sites where we have found evidence of middle Paleolithic age. Now, upper Paleolithic age. Upper Paleolithic age is again from 40,000 BC to 10,000 BC. And the sites are found in Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Central MP, Maharashtra, Southern Uttar Pradesh, Southern Bihar Plateau in India. These are the basically just a brief. Okay, these like what are the states in which the sites were find out. Okay. Let's understand the characteristics of Paleolithic age. What were their characteristics? First of all, an archaeologist was there. Guys, can you tell me what is archaeologist? Or who are archaeologists? What they do? What is their job? Anyone know? Who are archaeologists? Survey places, those who do research on history, those who study historical sites. Yes. Good. Yes. These are the persons who study, okay, the archaeological sites. Okay, they will find out various things. What are the things they have found, their time period, what those things represents. Yes, an archaeologist were there whose name was Archibald Carrilly. Okay, and he made the first discovery of rock paintings in the world in India. Okay, he was the first one who made the first discovery of. How many questions will get from this topic? Guys, it is not at all clear that from a certain topic, certain number of questions will be asked. Okay? It is not fixed and we can't even say also. Agar aisa hota, toh main tumhein wohi topic padha deta. Okay, if that was clear, I would have just straight away given you that topic. Alright? It is not clear. Sometimes they ask from modern history, sometimes they ask from ancient history. That's the case. Okay, he made the first discovery of rock paintings in the world in 1867 to 68. 12 years before the discovery of Altamira in Spain. Okay, and this, what is this Altamira? It is the site of world's oldest rock paintings. Oldest rock paintings. So when these Altamira sites in Spain were discovered, 12 years before that, this Archibald Carrilly, he discovered the rock paintings. Paintings are basically divided into three categories. Man paintings we have found out, animal paintings we have got, and some type of geometrical symbols we have also found out in the, we have perceived or we have got in the paintings. Man's we have seen, animals and geometric symbols. So what is the name of the person? Archibald Carrilly. Okay, yes. Now what were the characteristics of these early paintings? We'll understand what were the characteristics of these early paintings. Human beings are depicted in a stick-like form. Stick-like form means human beings will be depicted as something like this. Okay. In stick-like form, human beings were depicted. A fox, a multi-legged lizard are the main animal motifs in the early paintings. A fox, we have got an multi-legged lizard. Wavy lines, rectangular fielded geometric designs and group of dots. These are some geometrical things. Okay. Superimposition of paintings. superimposition of paintings means the first painting they would have made in black, then red, and then later white. Okay, the colors. First, they have made a painting in black, then red, and then later white. When you will take up the sides, okay, there are basically two series of sides where we have found out excellent prehistoric paintings. Bhimbetka Caves, foothills of Vindhyas in Madhya Pradesh. And the second type is Jogimara Caves, Amarnath in MP. Okay, these are the places where we have found out a very good, excellent prehistoric paintings. Are you guys with me? Are you guys with me? Yes. Everyone is alive, I suppose. Okay. Are you with me, Vishal? What happened here? What happened? Topic? What topic? What happened, Vishal? Sir, can you skip this and go to world history? No. That we can't do here. And in today's class, you have to study this. In the next class, we can do. If you guys agree. All right. This is just the starting, guys. Still so many things are there. Just relax and listen. It will be a long war. Okay, so you have to be with me. All right. Is it clear to everyone? Yes. History, it is so huge, yaar. Sir, which year did you give the NDA exam? I don't remember properly. Maybe 2015 or 16 or 17. I don't remember properly. Okay. Yes. Guys, listen. Achha, I will tell after the class, okay? Just remind me. Okay, I will tell something new after the class, okay? Just remind me. War is long, sir, but time is short. It is absolutely short. To study Indian history, how much time you know? You guys know it? To study just the Indian history, how much time you know? How much time is required? A minimum of 3 months alone. Infinity, yeah, that's a very good answer. Okay. A minimum of 3 months just to have a read. Okay. Just to go through the topics and what is there in it. 3 months time is required, minimum. And I am talking only about Indian history. I'm not even talking about world history and other aspects. Okay. It is so huge, so huge. All right. That's the thing. It is so huge. But don't worry. अच्छा यू गाइस लिसन, तुम्हें टेंशन हो रही है ना, सुन लो अब तुम मेरी बात. लिसन एवरीवन, ओके? एक ब्लैंक स्लाइड मिल जाए तो मजा आ जाए. वेट. Listen, everyone. अब ध्यान से सुनना जो मैं बताने वाला हूं. A very excellent thing I'm going to tell you. All right, see, your NDA exam. your when you will take up your NDA written, it is happening in two phases. One is your mathematics paper and one is your GAT paper. Am I right, guys? Right now? एक मिनट रुक जाओ, क्लियरली साफ साफ बताता हूँ तुम्हें सिस्टम क्या है. आई विल टेल यू अ वंडरफुल थिंग, ओके? जस्ट लिसन. आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू वेरी नाइस थिंग. सी, सो व्हेन यू विल टेक योर एनडीए एग्जाम, टेक अप योर एनडीए exam, it is going to happen in two papers. One is your maths paper and one is your GAT. In maths paper, what is the total number of marks? What is the total number of marks for mathematics? 300. Absolutely good. Number of questions? What is the number of questions? 120. Questions. All right. Yes. So for one question, what is the allotment of marks? 2.5. Very good. Similarly, let's come to GAT. In GAT, what is the total number of marks which GAT will give you? It is 600. Absolutely right. Very good. Oh, double than mathematics. It means GAT is important. You might be thinking, ki, sir, maths is only giving 300 marks. But sir, GAT is giving 600 marks. It's a hell lot of marks, sir. GAT is important. But listen, okay, what is the number of questions? 150, if I'm right. Yes, absolutely right. 150 questions. And what is the marks per question? Allotment of marks, marks per question. It is 4 marks per question. So these are some basics. Okay, now listen carefully. Listen, okay, let's further divide it. When you will take up your GAT paper, can I classify it in 3 sections basically? One is your English portion, one is your science portion, right? Sorry. I can broadly classify your GAT paper into 3 types. One is your English, one is your science portion, and one is your GS portion. Okay, in GS/GA, general studies and general knowledge. Okay, now listen. Fifty questions of science, 50 questions of GS. Am I right? My dear soldiers, tell me, am I right? 50 questions of English, 50 questions of science, 50 questions of GS, GK. Okay. Yes. Guys, can you tell me what is the cutoff of NDA? Approximately, what is the cutoff of NDA? Approximately, let's take it 350. Okay. Okay, 340 to 350. Okay, whatever it is. Not an issue. Now listen carefully. Okay, now. Listen carefully. What is the idea or what is the plan? suppose can you tell me which is the easiest portion in which you can easily score? What is the, like, between maths and GAT, between maths and GAT I'm asking. In GAT we'll further discuss. Okay, between maths and GAT, which is easier to score? Achha. Is it so? Can't decide equally both. Is it so? But I think your maths is easy to score, according to my opinion. Why maths is easy to score, guys? Because I will tell you, because in maths you already have the number of topics which are there and which are going to come, right? These are the certain number of topics. We already have the list, 11th and 12th maths book, right? The number of topics we know, the type of questions that can come on the mathematics, on those particular topics, we probably know. Okay, at least we know the, these are the list of topics which can be asked in the mathematics paper. Am I right? And clearly we can, during a maths lecture, Ankur sir might have told you that, he might have told you certain type of questions that is surely going to come in your mathematics paper. Am I right? Are matlab, surely in the sense important. These are important. Like, no, that's no one can tell you. Basically, sir, this question will come. Like, important. These can come. Yes. When you will come to the GAT part, can you guys tell me what are the list of topics which are going to come from your GAT paper? Okay, broadly we know English, Science and GS. But in English, in Science and in GS, particularly we know what are the topics which can come. In English, you know, comprehension will come, okay, errors will come, rearrange, fill in the blanks, antonym, synonyms. Okay, these are the list of topics which can come, or which which is going to come in your English paper. Very good. Can you tell me about Science? Can you tell me about GS or GK? Are physics, chemistry, bio, that we know. Specific topic. Ki, sir, suppose, let's say P block. Sir, P block se question aayega. Sir, optics se question aayega. Sir, magnetism se question aayega. Can we surely tell, sir, from this topic's question is going to come? Okay, but not each and every topic, to an extent we can tell. Sir, somewhat these are the topics in the science. Suppose magnetism, let's take. Okay, magnetism, optics we can take. Some topics we can tell, okay, but not all of it. Some topics we can tell in science. Can you tell me from GS and GK, in which your polity is there, history is there, geography is there, and general knowledge or current affairs is there? In this, can you tell? In this, Gandhi House se ek do question aata hai bas. From Gandhi and era, just one or two questions will come, yaar. Can you tell or not? So basically, even more less than, okay, if you might have got some topics, then well and good. But my idea is even more less than compared to science. Okay, very few number of topics we might be knowing. Okay, just a handful of topics, 1, 2, 3, or 5, 10, max to max 10 topics you might be know. Okay. So guys, now can you tell me which is easier to score? And see, in English, you know, like in, like what's the answer? We can clearly mention. In science, yes, you guys can score, you have studied science. In GS or GK, can you know what exactly the answer, what can be exactly the answer of any question? Or what is the type of question they will be asking? Okay. And what is the level of difficulty in GS or GK? Can we guess? Can we guess? Absolutely no. Okay. We can't guess the level of difficulty. Okay. Yes. So now can I say that, sir, or you guys agree with me that, sir, maths is easiest to score? Because in maths, we already know everything. First of all, we know the topics. We know the types of questions which can be framed on that particular topic, and the level of difficulty. And in mathematics, by elimination also, we can solve the questions. But in GS or in science, no such option is available. If you know the answer, then only you can take it. There is no such method of elimination. Am I right, guys? Am I right? Yes. Okay. Achha, ab suno aage. Listen. Just a handful. That's what I'm telling. Just a handful of questions you might be knowing in GS and GK or in science or in English. Okay, English probably is done. Science, but in particular GS. In mathematics, you know everything there. Okay. So basically, maths is your most important subject in which you can score maximum. All right. So out of 120 questions, a minimum of, let's suppose, 60 to 80 questions you can do in mathematics. If you are able to do 60 to 80 questions, students, please understand, maths is your most important. GAT is later. GAT, you will do it. I have faith in you. Okay, that you will clear GAT. That is not a problem. Okay. In maths, you have to do 60 to 80 questions. If you do 60 questions, what is the number of, what is the total marks? Achha. So it is 150. If you do 80 questions, then what is the total marks you might be getting from your maths paper? Okay. Well and good. Let's come to GAT. In GAT, see, 50 questions of English will be there. So out of these 50 questions, can you guys do a minimum of 40 questions? Or let's say 30 to 40. Let's take a range. 30 to 40 you can score. If you do 30 questions, then what is the total number of marks you will be getting? 120. And for 40, you will be getting 160 marks. Right? Yes. Now come to science part. You have already studied science in your 10th, 11th and 12th, and that too in detail. In detail. You have spent 2 years in studying just the science. And that too in detail. So out of 50 questions, guys, and the questions are not like, these are so easy questions. Just basic science, if you have studied in your 11th and 12th, you can easily, very easily do the science questions. Okay. So out of these 50 questions, you can do 30 to 40 questions. 30 questions. If 30 questions you are doing, what is the amount of marks you will get? Sorry to sir, but Ankur sir told about this plan. Arre, tum logon ne to send. Then you have earlier told me this, no? If sir, I've told you, you have already. Achha, just listen. Okay, we'll finish it off quickly. Okay, this will boost your confidence also. So out of this science, 30 question minimum also means 120 marks. And out of GS and GK, how many questions can you do? How many questions can you do? Minimum, just minimum. Achha, let's suppose you don't know anything. Or chalo 15 questions. Chalo, let's take 10 questions, yaar. Let's take 10 questions. So total of 40 marks. Just total this 120, 120, 240 means from your GAT paper, you guys are taking 240. From your GAT paper, you guys are taking 280 minimum. I am talking about minimum of 280 marks. I have not taken this maximum portion. Okay, just a minimum of 280 marks you are getting. And from your maths paper, if you do a minimum of 60 questions, you will be getting 150. So 280 plus 150, what is the total? What is the total? It is 430. And what is the maximum cutoff of NDA paper, guys? Just 350 maximum. And 430. So guys, according to me, your maths paper is at most important. At most important. At most important. Okay, in maths, you have to do a minimum of 60 questions. Okay, let's suppose if you clearly remove this GS part. Okay. Then also you will clear it. The GS portion is your bonus. Or otherwise, in this, from this, what do you call it? In science, if you have scored 15 also, then also it is well and good. Aur batao. This is the, like, guys, this is the minimum you have to do. This is the minimum. So that's the plan, guys, you should make and you should try to score. Okay. This should be the plan of your GAT. If you blindly study each and everything, it is no use. Things will get messed up, confusion will be there. Okay, sir, cutoff kitna hoga? Sir, maths mein. Maths cutoff, guys, a minimum of 60 questions you have to do to get into the, or to clear the return. Minimum of 60 questions. Okay. Or, chalo, for you, I will take just 50. Okay, a minimum of 50 correct questions you have to do to clear your maths paper. All right. Is it clear to everyone? Is it clear to everyone? Yes. So that's the plan you should follow and you should try to implement in your GAT, in your NDA exam. Guys, our aim is to just clear the written, nothing else. If return is clear, we are well and good, we are happy. Okay. Yes, that should be the plan you guys should follow. This GS portion, it is a bonus for you guys. English, very easy to score. Very easy. Okay. So how's the Josh now? How's the Josh? Got some confidence? Confidence aaya thoda? Low sir. Are. Yes. Okay. All right. Let's get back to our topic in which we were there. Okay, let's come to the Indian sites. What are the name of the sites which are there in Lower Paleolithic, Middle Paleolithic and Upper Paleolithic? Okay, let's take up the Indian sites. In Lower Paleolithic, we have Valley of Sohan in Punjab. Now it is in Pakistan. Kashmir and Thar Desert. Belan Valley in Mirzapur district, interesting. Bidwana in Rajasthan and Narmada Valley. These are the places of Lower Paleolithic age. Then when you will come to Middle Paleolithic, we have already discussed Narmada River Valley and Tungabhadra River Valley. And when you will come to Upper Paleolithic age, they are found in Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Central MP, Maharashtra, Southern UP and South Bihar Plateau. Right? Yes. Is it clear to everyone? Basics of Paleolithic Age. Basics. Just you have to go through it once. Basics of Paleolithic Age. Is it clear to everyone? Guys, are you guys sleeping? Anyone feeling sleepy? No, very good. Okay, let's go to Indus Valley Civilization. Okay, interesting. This topic is interesting. John Marshall was the first scholar who used the term Indus Valley Civilization. And the time period of Indus Valley Civilization is from 2500 to 1750 BC. 2500 to 1750 BC. This is the time period of... Okay. What is the geographical extent of Indus Valley Civilization? Okay. It basically extended from Suktagandur in Balochistan. You know guys, where is Balochistan? Anyone who knows where is Balochistan? Can anyone tell me where is Balochistan? Tell me where is Balochistan? Quickly tell me where is Balochistan. POK? No. Sir, who discovered it? What is the name which we are following? John Marshall. Balochistan, it is in western Pakistan. Okay. It is a province of western Pakistan. Baltistan is in POK. Okay. Yes. In Balochistan, in the west of Alamgirpur, and it is in western UP. From Suktagandur in Balochistan to Alamgir in western UP in the east, and from Mandu. Okay. See, this is west to east, eastern extent. Now, Mandu in Jammu and Kashmir, friends, in the north to Daimbad Bagh and Ahmednagar in Maharashtra. From north to south is this extent. If you take the west to east, it is from Suktagandor in Balchistan to Alamgirpur. And if you take north to south extent, it is from Daimabad. It is from, Mandu to Daimabad. Is it clear? Is it clear, guys? If you are good at mappings, it must be clear to you. Is it clear to everyone? Okay, those who are having a bit doubt, just refer your map, okay? You will get it. Don't worry. All right. This is your extent of Indus Valley civilization. This is the extent of Indus Valley civilization. Guys, give me. Just have a look. We'll straight away go to the main cities. Okay. So these are the number of cities. These are some of the main cities which were there in Indus Valley civilization. Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Lothal, Chanu-daro, Dholavira, Kalibagan, Banavali, Suktagandor, and Sukotada. Okay. These are the name of the cities. The Indus Valley civilization is also known as Harappan civilization because Harappa was the main city. Okay. And this Harappa city, it was on the river. It was on the bank of river Ravi. All right. And what are the things which we have found out? What are the important artifacts or things or features of Harappa is that a row of 6 granaries we have found from it. Granaries is basically... These are the big containers where grains can be stored. Mother goddess figure is found. Means a figure might be of any goddess. It is found there. When you will go to Mohenjo-daro, it is on the river of Indus. There we have found out great granary, great bath, image of Pashupati Mahadeva, image of black bearded man, and bronze image of a woman dancer. These are the things which we have found out in the Mohenjo-daro. The name of the things are important. Okay, questions can be asked from it. Like what are the things we have found from Mohenjo-daro, Harappa or the other cities. Alright. When you will come to Lothal, it is on the river Bhogava. And in Lothal, one important feature is there. It is a port city. Means in the Lothal, a port was there. Okay, a port which we have, a potential port we have found out there. Double burial, sir, who discovered Harappa?
Us bande ka naam tha, ya Desai karke tha uska. Wait, I will tell you. Some Desai something was the name. Just I'll find out later, yaar.
Okay.
RD. Yes.
RD Banerjee. RD Banerjee was the name of the person. Okay. Yes.
Okay. Now let's come to Chanu Dado. In Chanu Dado, it is on the river of Indus. And this is the only city which was without a citadel. Okay, I was explaining double burial. See, what is double burial means? When people were buried, I will tell you what is citadel. When people were buried, generally what we do, we dig out one grave and we bury one person in it, right? But in Lothal, double burials were found, means two persons were buried in the same grave. That is called as double burial. Okay, and that was, it was found in Lothal. It was found in Lothal. Just imagine, two people in the same grave, they are buried. Okay, and one terracotta horse figure were also found. When you will come to Chanu Dado, this was the pot burials, sir. Pot burials is different. Okay, in that artifacts, things and all which were put in. Okay. In Chanu Dado, this was the only city which was without a citadel. Citadel is basically when cities were developed, they were developed in two sectors, two segments were divided. First will be the outer, outer wall of that particular city. Then a main wall will be there. This main wall or how to describe it? Wait, let me see. See, when the city was developed, let's take Harappa. So this is the walls of Harappa. Okay. Whatever comes inside this wall or around this wall, it comes under Harappa. In Harappa, in that particular city, one more segment was there. Okay, one more segment was there, which was on a bit of height. Okay, the inner segment was built on a certain height. And whatever things were there in this inner segment, it was assumed that they were of a very much high importance. They carry a very high importance. They were very important. And everyone was not having access to this inner compound. Okay. Only the royal people or the important people who were there, they can only access this inner compound or the inner frame of this city. This inner part or this inner segment, we call it as citadel. Okay, it was only like fort, yes, you can say, not even fort, like they have made this citadel basically to distinguish themselves from the common people. In this area, all your common people will be living, and in this, only specialized, high rank officials, the persons who were having very high importance, they were living in the citadel. Okay, they were living in the citadel, or yeah, like capital, you can say, like capital. Okay, it was very special place, very special buildings were there. Okay, and these were all in the citadel. In Mohenjo-daro, might you have seen the Mohenjo-daro movie? Anyone seen Mohenjo-daro movie? Anyone? Yes, in Mohenjo-daro, you might have seen that there was a separate place for common people. Common people will be all living, and one more segment of the city will be there, in that all the high ranking officials and all will be living there. Okay, it is exactly what citadel is. All right, clear to everyone. Is it clear to everyone, guys? Is it clear to everyone? Okay. let's come to Chanu Dadu is done. Let's come to Dholavira. Dholavira, the city was divided into three parts. Okay, in Dholavira, the city was divided into three parts. And when Kalibagan, it is in Rajasthan on the river of Ghagar. There, plugged fields were found. There, plugged fields were found. Okay. Just remember Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Lothal, and Chanu-daro. Okay. What are the things which were found? I hope it is clear to everyone. Right? Yes. Let's go to the next part. We have to quickly rush through it, okay? Because it will take a lot of time. Let's go over the town planning and the structure of Indus Valley civilization. How the town planning was there? Okay. And how the towns were planned basically and what was the structure? Basically, in Indus Valley civilization, they follow grid system. Grid system means just like a chessboard. Towns were planned. One town will be there, another, something gap, another. Grid system was followed to make to develop the towns. Okay. Rectangular houses with brick-lined bathrooms and well together with the stairways were found. Okay, rectangular houses and some other features were there. Burnt bricks were used. Burnt bricks. Can anyone know what is the burnt bricks? Anyone? You guys know? Have you seen red brick? Anyone have seen red brick? Yes. That red brick, we call it as burnt brick. Why? Because first we will use the clay and sand, we will make a structure of the brick, then we will put it in the furnace. Okay. And in that furnace, that soil or that particular clay, it will get burnt and finally it will get hardened. As a result, we get burnt bricks. Okay. Yes. Underground drainage system was also there. Underground drainage system. And the citadel was fortified. Citadel was fortified means this is suppose your citadel. And all around the citadel, forts were developed. Forts were there or wall was there. So that no ordinary persons can come into the citadel. Right? Right, guys? Yes. Let's go for the agriculture aspect. Agriculture of Indus Valley civilization. Hindon, cotton and major trade goods. Okay. These were your major trade goods. Proof of rice husk is found. Wheat and barley were majorly cultivated during that time, and use of wooden plow was also used. Okay. At that time, the use of wooden plow means they were not having any idea of iron, how iron can be used. Okay. These are some of the agriculture aspects of Indus Valley civilization. Let's go for domestication of animals. Basically, oxen, buffalo, goats, sheep, and pigs. These are the list of animals which were domesticated at that time. Asses and camels were used as the beast. Were used as the beast of burden. Beast of burden means all the heavy works. Heavy works were carried out by the asses and camels. At that time, elephants and rhinos, they were also known. And in a particular Surkotada, remains of horses is found, and एविडेंस ऑफ हॉर्सेस इज ऑल्सो फाउंड इन मोहनजोदाड़ो एंड लोथल. ओके प्लीज रिमेंबर वेर द रिमेन्स और एविडेंस ऑफ हॉर्सेस इज फाउंड. इट इज फाउंड इन सुरकतोड़ा, सुरकोतड़ा, मोहनजोदाड़ो एंड लोथल. But only the remains were found. It does not mean that the civilization was horse-centric. It not at all represent that the civilization was horse-centric. Just the remains were found. No excessive use of horses. Clear? Clear, guys? Are you guys alive? Are you guys alive? Yes, very good. Half alive. That's the honest answer which I am getting from Ishwara Prasad. That's the honest answer. Very good. I can understand your feelings, dear. I can absolutely understand. Okay. Are you, it is good, na? Boring, sir. Absolutely is boring. No doubt in it. But we can't help you out. Can't help you guys out, okay? This is just the starting, guys. We are going to study a long history. Just wait for it, okay? Don't worry. The subject is boring, guys. I can't help. I am helpless. Okay? Let's go for the next slide. Let's understand what was the technologies and crafts which were there. Bronze means copper plus tin tools were used. Stone implements were still in vogue. Okay. Very rarely people were using stone implements. Potter's wheel was in full use. Potter's wheel. You guys know what is Potter's wheel? Yes. It is the wheel by rotating it and by applying clay and pressure, utensils are made. Okay. Containers are made. Bronzesmiths, goldsmiths, boat making, bricklaying, etc. were the occupations which are commonly found. These were the common occupations which were there at that time. Bronzesmiths, goldsmiths, boat making and bricklaying. So these were some of the technology and craft aspects in the Indus Valley civilization. Let's focus on the trade. How trade was happening in Indus Valley civilization? How trade was happening in your Indus Valley civilization? The presence of granaries, weights and measures, seals and uniform script signifies the importance of trade. See, we found out granaries, weights were found, measures were found, seals were there, uniform script. It all signifies that trade was also happening at that time and it was important. Okay. Barter system was widely used. Barter system, you guys must be aware of it, barter system. Okay. Lothal, Suktagandor were the port cities. These were the two port cities which were used for the trade activities. Right. And what were the trade destinations? Trade destinations were Afghanistan, Iran, and Central Asia. Contacts with Mesopotamia civilization has also been seen, but mainly Afghanistan, Iran, and Central Asia. Plus, you can add on Mesopotamia. Okay. So, granaries, weights, measures, seals, uniform script, barter system, Lothal, Suktagandor were the port cities. Trade destinations were Afghanistan, Iran, and Central Asia with Mesopotamia. All right. Is it clear, guys? Is it clear? Is it clear? Okay, so if it is clear, let's go to the next slide. That is political organization during Indus Valley civilization. Political organization, how politics were happening. Okay, what was the structure in the Indus Valley civilization? Cultural homogeneity was there, means nearly all cultures were same. Cultural homogeneity. There was no difference in the cultures, or very little, achieved through a strong central authority. Okay, a strong central authority was there, just like your central government. Okay, because of which cultural homogeneity was there, very little or very little difference in the cultures were there. No temples or religious structures were found. Very important. In your Indus Valley civilization, no temples and religious structures were found. Okay, it basically represents that Harappa was possibly ruled by merchants class. Okay, the merchants used to rule the Harappa, or you can call it as a whole Indus Valley civilization. And weapons were rarely found. Weapons were rarely found in the Indus Valley civilization. All right. Yes. Let's go for the religious practices. What were the religious practices? Earlier I have told one terracotta figure was found of mother goddess. All right. Phallu and Yoni worship. Possibly gods. Possibly. Okay. Not sure. Pashupati Mahadev seal was found. Probably some type of god, you can call it. Okay. And in that seal, elephant, tiger, rhino and a bull surrounding him with two deers near his feet. Sir, you told no religion in previous slide. Yes, I am telling no religion. And in this also, see, can you tell whether they are Hindu practice, whether they are Hindus, Muslims, Christians, or you can call it some other Sikh, Isai? Can you tell them? This is basically your religion, right? Hindu, not at all, yaar. In the previous slide, it is mentioned no temples were there. It seems to be like Hindu, but we are not at all sure. We are not at all sure. Okay, it can be some different religion. Okay, we are not at all sure. We can't say whether it is Hindu, Muslim, Christ, Sikh, Isai. Because in the previous slide, I have even told you that temples were not there. And temples are the basics of Hinduism. Okay. Yes, we can't tell. Some other religion, it seems like it is Hinduism, but we can't, we are not sure. All right? Yes. So these were some of the figures which were found. Tree and animal worship during the Indus Valley civilization. Peepal tree. Okay, at that time, peepal tree, people used to worship the peepal tree. Peepal is a type of tree, okay? One-horned unicorn, recognized as rhino, and a humped bull was commonly worshipped. They used to worship rhino and a humped bull and a one-horned unicorn. Use of amulets to ward off goats and evil spirits. Okay, some type of black magic, you can say. Okay, or their tradition, you can call it. People were practicing. At that time, lion was not known. Okay. Lion was not known in Harappan culture. Amulets. Guys, you know what is amulets? You know, guys, what is amulets? Amulets are basically some type of structures. Suppose a chain, you can call it, or some type of ring, you can call it, some type of bracelet, you can call it, okay, which we even use now, okay, and we think that by wearing that particular chains, bracelet, or some type of jewelry or ornaments, the ghost and evil spirits will not come. All right, so these were used at that times also, use of amulets. All right, yes, tree and animal worship. And guys, tree and animals were worshipped. What it basically represents, that at that time also people were knowing the importance of trees and animals. Basically, people were having a basic idea of flora and fauna. Not flora and fauna in the sense, but they know the importance of trees and animals. Let's talk about the script. The Harappan script. Harappan script is basically pictographic in nature. Pictographic means pictures were used. Okay. But till now, we haven't found out. Till now, they haven't been deciphered. Okay. We don't know what is the meaning of a particular picture and all. Okay. But we definitely know that pictures were used. They are recorded on seals and contains only a few words. Okay. Yes, they were recorded on seals. On seals, some type of pictures will be there and only a few words will be written. Harappan script is the oldest script in the Indian subcontinent. Okay. Remember, Harappan script is the oldest script in the Indian subcontinent. Right? Are you guys following? Is it clear? Is it clear, guys? Okay, let's go to the next slide. Weights and measures were also used. Okay. Weights and measures were used for the count of private property and for the use of trade and commerce. And weights were found basically in the multiples of 16. Weights were found basically in the multiples of 16. At that time, weights and measures were used. So, pottery. Well-developed pottery techniques with elaborate designs of trees and circles were there. Redware pottery painted with black designs. Okay, just basics of pottery was also practiced at that time. Seals of Indus Valley civilization. Seals of Indus Valley civilization. Seals were used basically for the purpose of trade or worship. Images of animals such as buffalo, bull, tiger, etc. were found inscribed in the seals. These are names of some of the animals which we have found in the seals. Which we have found in the seals. Dog, not, no. No, dear. In seals, they were not used. Ganesh, okay. Statue. In the Indus Valley civilization, we have also found out a statue. Discovery of a bronze statue of a naked woman and a bearded man. Steatite. Steatite is a type of material. Okay, steatite is a type of material. Basically, in the Indus Valley civilization, we have found out the bronze statue of a naked woman and a bearded man. All right? Yes. Then terracotta figures, which we have also found out. Terracotta figures. Terracotta is basically fire baked earthen clay. Terracotta is basically fire baked earthen clay. And from terracotta, toys or objects of worship were made. Massive stoneworks were not found in Harappa. Massive stoneworks were not found in Harappa, which shows that poorly developed artistic work made of stone. Okay. Which shows that poorly developed artistic works made of stone. People were not specialized. Basically, we can say. Right? Yes. Next. Understand the origin, maturity, and end of Indus Valley civilization. So these were some of the features, characteristics of Indus Valley civilization. Right? Yes. Now, let's understand about origin, maturity, and end of Indus Valley civilization. How it got ended. Pre-Harappan civilization time period was from 1900 to 2550 BC. What are the causes of decline of Harappan civilization? The causes of decline of Harappan civilization are, it is not sure, first of all. We have assumed, all right, these are all just the theories. Decreasing fertility due to increasing salinity on the account of expansion. Okay, fertility was decreasing. Floods, you can call. Second, earthquakes. All right. And it is also assumed that Harappan culture was destroyed by the invading Aryans. These are some of the possible happenings due to which the Indus Valley civilization was ended. We are not sure, just we have assumed. These are the possibilities. Then the post-urban phase. Post-urban phase means after this Indus Valley civilization, what happened? Sub-Indus culture emerged, primarily Chalcolithic. Okay, development of Ahar culture, Malwa culture, there is not at all required. Okay, it is not at all required. Who were Aryans? Anyone know who were Aryans? Anyone any idea about Aryans? Europeans, these were the people who came from the Middle East. Okay, who came from the Middle East. Basically, they were kings. It is assumed they were kings. These are the people who came from the Middle East through your Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, then India. Okay, yes. Okay. So guys, this was all about your Indus Valley civilization. This was all about your Indus Valley civilization. Is it clear to everyone? Is it clear to everyone? Is it clear to everyone? Yes. Now tell me, you guys want a break? I guess you guys want a break. You guys are very much desperate for a break. Right? Can we take a short break, guys? Can we take a short break? Yes. Okay. We'll take a short break. All right. Yes. Time now is 7:26 in my watch, be back by 10 minutes. Okay, be back by 7:35. All right, yes, we'll take a just 10 minutes short break, just fresh up quickly. All right, see you at 7:35. Okay, yes. Yes, everyone is there, right? Quickly tell your friends. Okay, कोई दिक्कत नहीं. Okay, I hope you have enjoyed the break. Right? Yes. Can we start? Can we start our class, guys? Can we start? Yes. All right. Okay. So with this, we have finished our Indus Valley civilization. Right? We have finished our Indus Valley civilization. Now we will go for early Vedic period. Now we will go for our early Vedic period, which was from 1500 BC to 1000 BC. Which was from 1500 BC to 1000 BC. Vedic period. We will learn about Vedic period, what all things are there, their characteristics, etc., etc. Okay, we learned a lot of things. All right. Yes. Let's see what is there in Vedic period. All right.
Yes.
First, we will talk about early Vedic period. Early Vedic period was from 1500 to 1000 BC. All right. And Rig Veda. You might have heard Rig Veda is the only source of knowledge of this period. All right. Whatever knowledge we have got of early Vedic period, it is all from Rig Veda we have got. Rig Veda is the oldest text in the world. In the world, guys. Rig Veda is the oldest text in the world. Okay. It contains 1028 hymns divided into 10 mandalas. Mandalas means 10 sections. Vedic literature was composed in Sanskrit. It was all in the language of Sanskrit. To begin with, the Vedas were recited and not written. You guys already know that in the earlier times, what knowledge was transferred verbally or orally. Okay, people don't used to write things. They will just simply sit with you. They will speak the whole story and knowledge. Okay, so that's how the knowledge was transferred from one person to another. It was not written. Okay, they were taught by the oral method. Basically, oral method was used. Hence, that's why they were called as Shruti and Smriti. Shruti and Smriti. Shruti means heard and Smriti means memorized. Okay, but later on what happened? They were reduced to the writings after the invention of the scripts. Scripts. Once the scripts were invented, whatever the teachings, the information was there, it was noted down. Okay. Yes. So these are some basic things about Vedas. Let's go for the next slide. Okay. Original home and identity and geographical area. Okay. Let's see what is there in this. Okay. First thing first. Aryans. Somebody was asking about Aryans. Aryans are basically Indo-European language family. Okay. Which is widely disseminated in the Eurasian region. Their origin is in the Eurasian region, somewhere in the Middle East or parts of Eurasia, you can call it. Max Müller opines, says that they have lived in Central Asia, region, and they have also invaded the Indian subcontinent. They have, okay, Max Müller cited that they lived in the Central Asia and they have also invaded the Indian subcontinent. And how do we know this? We know this because names of certain animals and plants are common to Indo-European languages. Some of the animals were names, and the names of animals and plants, it is both common in Indo-European languages. These were cited as the proof. The main occupation basically was pastoral, while agriculture remained as the secondary. Okay, agriculture remained as the secondary. Their primary occupation was pasture, right? And agriculture was their secondary occupation. Horses played a significant role in pastoralistic life. Okay, and they were also domesticated. Horses were domesticated near the Black Sea. Now, basically, where this term Arya appears, okay, the term Arya appears in Rig Veda for 36 times. And when you will open up Rig Veda, the term Arya, it have appeared about 36 times, indicating that Aryans as a cultural community. Aryans was basically a cultural community. Aryans appeared in the Indian subcontinent around 1500 BC and settled near eastern Afghanistan, northwest frontier province, Punjab, and fringes of western Uttar Pradesh, which I have told you, like the civilization somewhat similar to Indus Valley civilization. Okay, the whole region is called as Land of Seven Rivers. This whole region is called as the Land of Seven Rivers, where these Aryans appear to be present. The Aryans came into conflict with indigenous inhabitant Dacius, and the Aryan chief who overpowered them is called as Tarsa Dasu. Okay, Tarsa Dasu, some minor kings and names. Basically, the indigenous inhabitants were Dasyus, and the Aryan chief who overpowered them was Tarsa Dasu. Saptasindhu is mentioned in our Vedas. Now, what is Saptasindhu? Saptasindhu is mentioned in our Rig Vedas, right? Sindhu is there. It is also mentioned in our Ramayana, Sindhu. Sindhu is the river of par excellence, while the Saraswati or Naditarna is the best rivers in the Rig Veda. These are some of the names of the important rivers which were there. All right. Just some basic, their history and all. Who were they? Where they come from? Okay. What are the areas they basically live in? Aryans. Let's go to the next slide. Now, basically the rivers, they were having two names. Okay, one is your Rigvedic name, and the today what is the modern name of it? Sindhu, the modern name is Indus. Vitasta, it is now called as Jhelum. Askini, it is Chenab. Parshuni, it is Ravi. Vipass, it is Bias. And finally, Satluj, it was called at that time as Suttudri. These are the other names of rivers, or you can say the Vedic names of the rivers. Is it clear, guys? Is it clear to everyone? Yes, some of the names. Now, tribal conflicts. What was happening? Tribal conflicts. What the Aryans introduced was, they introduced chariots driven by horses. Okay. And this was happening for the first time. This was happened for the first time in the West Asia and India. They use horses. They use chariots driven by the horses. They were better equipped with arm and varman. Okay, arms and ammunitions they were having. That was the basic reason, okay, for their success of conquest everywhere. That's why they won. They were having better equipments, better movement of way, they were having better chariots and all. That's why they succeeded. That is the reason they succeeded. Aryans were basically divided into five tribes. Okay, there were basically five tribes of Aryans, which was called as Panchjana. Panchjana, who fought among themselves. They used to fight among themselves. Everyone wants power. Okay, so they used to fight among themselves. The Battle of Ten Kings, it is very famous. The Battle of Ten Kings or the Dasarajan War. Rajan, Rajan means king, Das means ten. Okay, clearly in Hindi. In Hindi, Das means ten and Rajan means Raja. So the Battle of Ten Kings was fought between five Aryans and five non-Aryan tribes against Bharata King Sudas, in which Bharata won. In which Bharata won. They later joined with Purus and established a new tribe called Kurus, which ruled the upper Gangetic plain. Some just Battle of Ten Kings, it was fought between five Aryan and five non-Aryan tribes against Bharata King, and in that Bharata King won it, right? Yes. Tribal conflict. These were some of the tribal conflicts which were happening in the Aryans itself. Okay, in the Aryans itself, right? Material life and economy. How things were happening in their material life and economy. Guys, are you following? Are you following? Yes. Let's talk about their material life and economy. Their success is attributed to the use of chariots. Why they succeeded? Because they used chariots, horses. They were having better arms, okay, which were made up of bronze. They also introduced spoked wheel. They were also having a better knowledge of agriculture, which was used mainly to produce fodder. They were having very good knowledge of agriculture. But sir, which place this happened, sir? Ten Kings. I have to find it out, dear. It is not that much important. Okay. These all things, they are very needs to be found out. Okay. Yes. I'll find it out. See, history is a very vast subject. It's very vast. Still now, we haven't found out each and everything of our history. Still, we are in that learning phase. We are in that finding out phase. Okay. Yes. Plowshare made up of wood was mentioned in Rig Veda. It means Aryans used plows, okay, for their fields and all. Wars were fought for the sake of cow. See, one important thing. Wars were fought for the sake of cow. For the sake of cow means for cows. Means cow was the price. Gavisthi is called the search of cows. The land was not important in their life. See, at that time, they were not at all interested in the land. As it is happening now, people are interested in more of a land. Okay, we want, as China, see, China wants more and more of a land. But at that time, people were not at all interested in the lands. they were interested in the cows. So basically, the fights, the wars were happening for the cows. Whoever won, they will get the cows. And there is, it is not like, there's a very good reason of it. Why? Because at that time, they were not good at, they were not producing any crops and all from the agriculture. Okay. At that time, many famines and all were happening. Right. Scarcity of food was there. And when the person who is having a cow, the person who is having a cow, he is well versed to lead a satisfied life. Through cow, he will get milk. Okay. The cow will also protect them from other animals to an extent. To an extent. Okay. And at that time, during a famine, all your agriculture, etc., etc., will get destroyed. But what is the constant thing which they were having is the cow. Even in the case of a famine, the cow will save the particular person's family, their children, their wives and all from that particular famine. So that's why buffalo can be, I'm not sure. Can be. Okay, these can be the reasons. Okay, not sure. These can be the reasons. But cow needs fodder. So they will get from the agriculture, na? And fodder, it is not at all necessary to be grown somewhere. Okay, if you go to the your village and all, people, okay, now people are growing fodder for the cows and all. But at that time, so much of grasses, plants and were that people just used to leave their cows for 1 or 2 hours. The cows will itself find the fodder and all, they will eat back, they will come, they will give the milk and all, etc. Okay, so that can be one of the reasons why the wars were fought for the cows. For them, what are the importance of cows were there. Aryans never, can be the reason, okay, right, guys. Aryans never lived or settled in the cities. They never lived or settled in the cities. So this was all about their material life and their economy. What did they eat? They maybe non-veg, veg, we don't know. Okay, we are not sure of it. Okay, yes. So guys, tribal polity, okay, yes. So guys, I guess with the material life and economy, we should wind up today's session, because as I can see, things are getting overloaded for you, right? And it is becoming so much of boring. Am I right, guys? Yes, otherwise things will get overloaded and you guys will sleep, or you, like, the interest will definitely get decreased. All right? Yes, yes, yes. Slowly we'll study. Okay, what are the important things? Okay, and in history, guys, we will not study each and every topics. After this ancient history, we will straight away go to the modern history. Okay, because modern history is important, from that questions are coming. 1 or 2 or 5 or 10. Okay, yes. We'll go through it. Guys, PPT, see, it is nothing like I have searched from somewhere, from some something and something. It is just search the internet, you will get it. Okay. Basics of, just take your NCERT book. Just take the NCERT book. You don't have time, then guys, no need to go for other. Just, everyone should be having your Aryant book. Just go through once. Through your Aryant book. Okay. Yes. You don't have time to go through all this PPT. It is a 100 slide PPT here. You won't be able to read it. That's why. Just go through your that book, particular book. It will be more than enough for you. Okay. And you guys already know, it is just the bonus which we are trying to get. Right. According to our plan, it is already a bonus. All right. If possible, I will send you. Okay. Don't worry. Okay, guys, with this, we will wind up today's session. In the next session, we will continue with the Vedas and then we will go for the modern history and all. All right. So, guys, I hope you have enjoyed, you have understood the concepts and all. Okay. Enjoyed the class. All right. Yes. So, see you in the next class. I hope you have enjoyed the class. Thank you for your time, guys. Thank you. See you in the next class. Jai Hind.